So, Doc, what do you see as the role for THC and CBD in the practice of medicine?
Both compounds are of extreme interest, but not for the same diseases. I mean, I'm speaking now of the medical side alone. I'm not speaking of the recreational part. And in the medical side, there are diseases, there are disease states that THC is more important than CBD. And there are other disease states where CBD is more important. For example, in autoimmune diseases, diseases in which the body attacks itself for various reasons, CBD seems to be much better than THC. For example, in diabetes type 1, it is a disease in which the body attacks the cells that produce insulin. And CBD, cannabidiol, is much more important than THC. In other disease states like trauma, it is apparently THC is more important.
So, Doc, what role do you see cannabis playing in upregulating the endocannabinoid system?
The endocannabinoid system is of extreme importance. On the health side, there was just a review recently by senior people at NIH, and they wrote that the endocannabinoid system is involved in essentially all human diseases. And that means also in states. And so obviously it's of extreme importance. Now, does it help situations which are not really clinical? Most of us are anxious at some point or another, or slightly depressed at one point or another. These are not clinical situations. These are situations of every day. And chances are that, yes, cannabidiol can affect that. Cannabidiol most definitely affects anxiety, most definitely helps with depression. So if it's extreme, then of course it's a disease. But many of these things are not extreme. And in this case, cannabidiol, I believe, can help.
I know you've been on the front lines of looking at head injury and American football, and that's coming up as a big topic in American society right now. What are some of the most interesting things that are happening in that field?
Well, American football has a lot of problems. And some of the problems are head injury, close head injury. And some of the people that smoke cannabis after football take it for the head injury rather than as an anti-opiate compound. And yes, cannabidiol, in mice at least, is a good agent against the head injury. We've tried that. I collaborate with Professor Esti Shohami, and she's a specialist in this field, and she has found that yes, cannabidiol definitely helps with brain injury. Quite a few other compounds do the same. But again, we don't have a clinical trial. It's not simple to do it. But we need better clinical trials. I'm under the impression that it helps.
One of the things that we found is that there's a lot of interest in the field of medical cannabis for children who are having seizures and so forth. What's been your experience with that?
Many years ago, about 35 years ago, or even more, we did a clinical trial with cannabidiol. First, of course, we did a lot of work in mice. Then we found that the compound is not toxic, that the compound can help with epileptic attacks in mice. So we went and did a clinical trial in human patients, not children. We had 15 patients. Half of them were controls. Half of them took cannabidiol, relatively high doses. And we were amazed how good it was. We found that out of the eight patients that nothing was helping them anymore, out of these eight patients, four had no attacks while they were given cannabidiol. Three patients had much less, and only one was not affected. And that was 35 years ago. Now, I'm not a clinician, and at the university we don't have the ability to the money to do a clinical trial, and I expected that neurologists will pick up this initial work and expand it. Nothing happened. For 30 odd years, nothing happened. I mean, that's a shame, because we could have helped children or adults over that period of time. And again, nothing happened. I used to go to neurologists, say, well, we can't do it. We don't have the facilities. Cannabidiol comes from marijuana, from hashish. Of course, we will never get a permit, etc., etc. So for 35 years, nothing happened until parents found that it helps their children, and they started giving them cannabis with the high levels of cannabidiol, and in many cases, about 60-70% of cases, it helped the children. Now, why did we have to wait for 35 years after an initial clinical trial? Small one, yes, but it showed that it works. Many drugs, many major drugs, started with a small trial. It still doesn't happen with most diseases where we know that cannabidiol helps. We know that patients are using it without having a clinical trial. I don't want to use a strong word, but it's a shame that this has not happened.
Doc, where do you get the most hope for change in a medical system, particularly with medical cannabis, that's been slow to adapt?
Well, I'm under the impression that things are changing. For many years, there were no clinical trials in the US, major clinical trials, period. Now things are changing. And I believe that there will be clinical trials, particularly with cannabidiol, less so with THC, because THC has its side effects. But there are enough things to do at the moment with cannabidiol itself. We had in Israel a clinical trial with an autoimmune disease, or a kind of autoimmune disease. In some cancer patients, the bone marrow has to be exchanged. And these people get bone marrow from the outside. The body doesn't like it and it attacks the bone marrow. It's kind of an autoimmune disease, not real, but a kind of autoimmune disease. The bone marrow that has been administered or that had been put in the body attacks the body attacks the bone marrow, and the patient is sick, at times very sick. So a clinical group at one of the hospitals in Israel tried high doses of pure cannabidiol. Very high doses, 300-400 milligrams, and yes, it lowered many of the effects of this graft versus host disease. This is a name people usually use. So it works. It most definitely works. And as a matter of fact, a company has taken it over and is developing it. Here we have something that has clinical trial background, and I hope that we shall see many more. In another field, in schizophrenia, we showed many, many years ago in a few patients, a very few, one or two, that it helps, in cannabidiol helps in schizophrenia, and a German group did a large clinical trial, very well done, published, and it showed that very high doses of cannabidiol, about 800 milligrams a day or even more, definitely help with schizophrenia. Now, schizophrenia is a serious disease. We have 1% of the population in the world that has schizophrenia. Now, that's a lot of patients. And we need additional drugs, because the drugs available now, they're pretty good. Some of them are excellent, but most of them cause side effects. Cannabidiol causes essentially no side effects. Mm-hmm. So we need more clinical trials in schizophrenia, but it has been shown that it works.
Doc, what are some of the ways that you've seen that cannabis can be used most effectively in medicine at this stage?
In Israel, cannabis has to be approved by the Ministry of Health, which is the FDA in this case, and we have 26,000 patients that use cannabis for medical purposes. Most of them use it for pain, mm-hmm. not acute pain. If you're going to have your tooth taken out, it's not for that. But it's for constant pain, neuropathic pain, pain that quite a few people have. And it helps. Most of the people, most out of these 26,000 patients, use it for pain, not all of them. And yes, it definitely helps. Again, we need better clinical data. Anxiety is a very complicated situation and very difficult to measure. People use it, it helps, but then again, we need more data. The same is true for depression. We need better depression drugs. Depression of A is not the same as depression in B and C and D. So we need a lot of more clinical data.
So I know in the past, Doc, you've been maybe a little bit critical of the use of cannabis for recreation. Can you clarify some of your thoughts on that?
Well, I've not been critical. I just state that the medical use and the recreational use should be separate. Mm-hmm. The medical use should be based on medical data. And it should be advanced as modern drugs are advanced through clinical, through animal trials, through clinical trials, to everything that the new drug needs. The recreational use is a social issue. If the population of a certain state, certain country, wants to have cannabis open to everybody or to most people in the after a certain age, then that's fine. But it's a social issue. It has to be decided on a different background. Our population decided centuries ago that tobacco is fine. Although now we know that tobacco is a toxic agent, but it's a social issue. The society has decided it's okay. You can use it if you wish. The same is true for cannabis. You can use it if you wish, if the population of a certain state, country decides so. It's a social issue.